I'd like to welcome everyone here in our audience to our November 16th meeting, those that are joining us by television. I'd like to thank Commissioner Tolson and congratulate him on his reelection and thank him for what he's done. He's always attended our planning board meetings and been very supportive of his planning board. And at this time, we have our roll call.
Hey, Barefoot.
Here.
Brad Guth.
Here.
RJ Hemby.
Here.
Aaron Hines. Ricky Hines.
Here.
Clayton Malloy Jr.
Here.
Matt Nobles. Johnny Penner.
Here.
Kenneth Ross.
Here.
And Mr. Chairman, Anthony Herring and Danny Smith will be absent tonight.
Okay, thank you. At this time, we have our prayer by Fay Barefoot. Our allegiance will be by RJ Hemby. We all stand up.
Our Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for the many blessings of life. And we pray just now, Father, that you would bless in this meeting as we carry on a portion of thy business. We thank you, Father, for those that are here tonight and that can that will be standing in the meetings tonight. So, Father, have your willing way. And again, thank you for all that you do for us. In your name, amen.
Amen.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have the approval of minutes. I hope all of you read the September 21st meeting minutes and have a motion that we approve the minutes.
Motion to approve.
Okay, and second it. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
At this time, I ask James Rose if he'll come up for number four.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A few administrative items tonight, of course. We do have one new member with us tonight. Mr. Brad Guth has joined us. We certainly appreciate him coming online. He is representing District 6, and his first full term will run through the end of September in 2019. So, and you may recall he is replacing Lyman Hardy that spent a full two terms with us previously. So just want to make that recognition. And kind of with the new appointments and other changes, we also need to elect officers tonight. This is our first meeting after our normal October election. Since we didn't have a meeting last month, we'll actually take care of that tonight. And with us tonight is our assistant county attorney, Jordan Smith, that will lead you through that. So, Jordan.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the planning board. As James said, my name is Jordan Smith. I'm assistant county attorney. I'll lay out some of the parameters of the election process of your officers. We'll be electing a chair and a vice chair tonight. Any member can nominate any other member of the planning board, including him or herself. Nominations don't require a second. And if there are multiple nominations, we'll vote on those nominations in reverse order. And with that, I'll open the floor to nominations for position of chair.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to offer in a motion Mr. Johnny Penner as chair.
Okay, thank you. Any other nominations? Seeing none, we'll close it.
All right. All in favor of Johnny Penner being appointed chair of the planning board, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
I believe that carries. Same rules apply for the appointment of an election of vice chair. If there aren't any questions, I'll open the floor up to nominations for vice chair.
I nominate Ricky Hines.
Okay, Ricky Hines has been nominated. Any other nominations? Declare the nomination closed. We'll vote on Ricky Hines.
All in favor?
Oh, say aye.
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 Believe that okay. Carries. And one final housekeeping matter. James Rhodes, the planning director, needs to be appointed as the executive secretary of this board.
So I make a motion to be appointed executive secretary of the board.
I second.
Okay.
Vote. All in favor?
All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. congratulations to the new officers. And with that, we'll take just a minute to reshuffle the chairs.
Oh, we have one more item to take care of. That is to administer the oath to our newest member, Mr. Guth, and Tabitha's going to do that.
I state your name.
Brad Guth.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support and maintain.
That I will support and maintain.
The Constitution and laws.
The Constitution and laws.
Of the United States.
Of the United States.
And the Constitution and laws.
The Constitution and laws.
Of North Carolina.
Of North Carolina.
Not inconsistent.
Not inconsistent.
Therewith.
Therewith.
And that I will faithfully.
And that I will faithfully.
Discharge the duties.
Discharge the duties.
Of my office as a member.
Of my office as a member.
Of the Pitt County Planning Board.
Of the Pitt Planning Board.
So help me God.
So help me God. Thank you.
All right, congratulations, Brad.
Thank you. Congratulations.
The next item on the agenda is a zoning ordinance text amendment concerning recreational vehicles and tiny houses, and that's Mark.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the Planning Board. My name is Mark Nottingham, planner with the Pitt County Planning Department, and tonight the First Amendment is regarding recreational vehicles and tiny houses. And these amendments are proposed due to some guidelines we received from the North Carolina Department of Insurance, Office of the State Fire Marshal, and also the Department of Public Health. The First Amendment is to the table of permitted uses in the zoning ordinance. This will add the recreational vehicles sites as a permitted use in rural agricultural and rural residential zoning districts. And they will be permitted in these districts with development regulations. The first regulation is regarding separation and setbacks. So RV sites would be required to meet setbacks set for single family houses. That's 30 to 40 feet on the front property line and 10 feet on the sides and rear. And we've also included a regulation regarding temporary occupancy. So RVs are not allowed to be accepted as permanent dwelling units unless they are dual labeled through either the North Carolina Modular Construction Program or through the HUD Manufactured Housing Construction Program. So if they're not permitted through one of those programs, they're limited to temporary living quarters for recreational camping, travel, or seasonal use, not to exceed 180 continuous days in a 12-month period. And they're not permitted to have any permanent plumbing or mechanical connections. The second section of proposed amendments is to the RV park development regulations. Right now, we're extending. There wasn't a clear definition of temporary from the state, temporary occupancy. So we're extending, it used to be 3 months of continuous occupancy. We're extending that to 180 continuous days. And we're cleaning up the utility requirements section for RV parks, getting a little bit less specific and just saying that the electrical supply system for RV parks would be required to be installed and inspected in accordance with the North Carolina Electrical Code. And along that same note, all water supply and wastewater facilities, including dump stations, shall have the approval of Pitt County Environmental Health. The third section of amendments, proposed amendments, is to the definition section of the zoning ordinance. And this amendment is to the definition for dwelling unit. And, you know, we're adding the statement that recreational vehicles not constructed through the North Carolina Modular Construction Program or through the Manufactured Housing Program cannot be accepted as permanent dwelling structures in the state. And there are different types of RVs, so we felt the need to include a definition for park model RVs. They're a single living unit that's primarily designed and completed on a single chassis mounted on wheels to provide temporary living quarters for recreational, camping, or seasonal uses. It is certified by the manufacturers complying with the requirements of ANSI A119.5. They have a gross trailer area not exceeding 400 square feet in the setup mode, or have a gross trailer area not exceeding 320 square feet in the setup mode, with the width greater than 8.5 feet in the transport mode. But park models, like you may see in some beach communities, can be set up for permanent occupancy. They just have to be constructed and dual labeled through either the modular construction program or through HUD with the manufactured construction program. To further clarify the temporary time frame, we've added that sentence in there for the definition of recreational vehicle, that the temporary shall be considered a period no more than 180 continuous days in a 12-month period. One of the other big changes that we're proposing is the number of RVs that would constitute an RV park. In the past, it was you could have 15 RVs would constitute an RV park. Right now, we're based on some of the guidelines we've received, we're reducing that number or proposing to reduce it down to 3 RVs would constitute an RV park. That brings it in line with the number of manufactured homes that constitutes a manufactured home park. The guidelines we received from public health classified an RV park as 2 RVs. So we're proposing 3 to match with our zoning ordinance in manufactured home parks. Last, but sometimes least in size, is a definition for tiny houses. Tiny houses can be considered a single family house. They can be constructed through the HUD manufactured home program or through the modular program. So if they're constructed through that, they can be, you know, set up for permanent occupancy. But if they don't meet any of those guidelines, then it will be considered a recreational vehicle and just be allowed for temporary occupancy. So that definition basically states that. Any amendment to our zoning ordinance is required to be consistent with our comprehensive land use plan. So we believe the proposed amendments will help maintain the character and appearance of the various communities located within Pitt County, and that they're reasonable and in the public interest because they'll help ensure that future applicants know how RVs and park models and tiny houses may be permitted and occupied, while also maintaining compliance with North Carolina Building Code and public health regulations. So the staff's recommendation is to forward this draft amendments to the county commissioners with a favorable recommendation.
Question?
Yes, sir.
The I noticed here you say 180 days. Who monitors the days and when they start?
That's going to be difficult to enforce. We're putting that language on the permit, but I don't know if there's a way that we could, you know, monitor the occupancy every day of a recreational vehicle. They will be required to just be set up temporarily and have the wheels on them and not be anchored down. No permanent mechanical or plumbing connections will help ensure that, you know, it doesn't become a, you know, a permanent occupancy RV.
Thank you.
Sure.
I guess if you got complaints from the neighbors, that's when you would know that it was there for longer than 120 days.
Good point.
That's how a lot of our zoning enforcement works, is based on complaints.
Yeah. Word of mouth is used to take care of
right.
those problems.
Can you explain the designation for those that can be considered permanent? I know you were talking about certain ones can be considered
sure.
for permanent use.
There's labels that they put on RVs. And so an RV, you know, like going down the road can have like multiple labels on it. So it could just be, you know, just a regular RV and it'll have just an RV label on it. Or it could be dual labeled as a, you know, constructed through a modular housing program. And it'll have that additional label on it. Or, you know, it might have the manufactured home label on it, and it could be set up that way. Those will be required to be anchored down or on a, you know, a permanent foundation.
So it just has to meet those standards if someone wanted to live in, you know, live in them temporary, I mean, for more than 180. Yeah.
Correct. Yes.
Okay, okay.
So the amendment process is as follows. Public comments can be entertained now by the planning board. And then the planning board will make a recommendation to the county commissioners. And they're scheduled to hold a public hearing regarding this request on December 19th. And at that time, they'll take action on their request. I can answer any more questions you might have, or you can open up for public comments.
Any more questions for Mark before we move into public comment?
Are we doing this in anticipation of dealing with issues, or have we already had applications?
We've had some requests. Okay. Most of this is spurred on just by the, you know, recent guidelines we received from the state.
Okay.
Anybody else? Okay, we do have one person listed here, John Powers. So, Ms. Powers, you'll come forward now. I just remind you that we have a three-minute limit on.
Yes, sir. Certainly. I only have just a few comments. I'm sure you normally expect individuals such as myself. I am owner and operator of Whispering Oaks RV Resort here in Greenville, out on the north side of the river, on Sunnyside Road. I'm sure you're normally anticipating someone coming up here and disputing these changes and all. I just wanted to assure the board that I am all for these changes. We have a very nice situation going on where we are with 12 sites right now. Everything is going great. Everything's fine. No complaints from any neighbors. Life is good, in a nutshell. I just wanted to come up this evening and take an opportunity. Your question was in reference to enforcement of the 180 days. I would put that solely on the responsible owner and operator of the RV park. In addition to, like Mr. Nottingham said, any neighborhoods in complaints they may receive. But I feel like that our facility right now is a complement to our county. It's a valued resource pertaining to ECU, pertaining to Vidant Medical Center, is where we get a lot of our visitors from, especially on the ball game weekends, needless to say. And we are very supportive of these changes. I would like to personally compliment and thank Mr. Rhodes, Mr. Eric Gooby, Mr. Kent Keeter, Mr. Brent Jones, and Mr. Mark Nottingham for all of their due diligence and work on this item. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
I have a question for you. Do you see many tiny houses?
I'm sorry, sir.
Do you see many tiny houses out there in your park?
No, sir. Don't allow them. No, sir. Do not allow them. Okay. No, sir. They are, as Mr. Nottingham stated, or in the industry-wise, uh-huh. with my 25 years' experience, they're considered more of a permanent housing.
Right.
Yes, sir. Even if they don't take the wheels and axles off, they're uh-huh. just kind of set up for more of a permanent housing.
Okay.
Any other questions or concerns? Thank you very much for your time. I certainly appreciate it, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Powell. It's always good to hear positive comments, I would guess.
So with that, the staff's recommendation is to forward this draft amendment language to the county commissioners with a favorable recommendation.
So do I.
I make a motion that we forward to the county commissioner with a favorable recommendation.
I second it.
All right, motion been made by Mr. Ross and seconded by Ricky. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, alike.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Okay, Mr. Eric.
All right, thank you, Mr. Chairman. This next item, this was sort of a late addition to your agenda. It was not included in the mail packet, but you should have it in front of you tonight. This is a request to modify the distance from a property that we send out mailed public hearing notices. And this is basically in an effort to try to solicit additional public comment for these public hearings. And this would apply to rezoning requests, conditional use permits, special use permits, variances, that sort of thing. So any type of development request that requires a zoning public hearing, this would have to, these mail notices have to meet this requirement. North Carolina General Statutes 153A-343 does require us to send mail notice not only to the owner of the property that's subject to the request, but also the owners of all parcels of land that abut that parcel of land as shown on the county tax listing. So essentially any adjacent property is required to have a mail notice sent to them. And currently under our zoning ordinance, we actually go a little above and beyond that. We send out notices to every property owner within 100 feet of the property. And so if you have a property that's an adjacent property that's less than 100 feet, say maybe 75 feet wide, it's also going to pick up that property on the other side of it. So we do kind of go above and beyond. But what we've seen is that maybe some of these larger tracts of land that require notice, maybe for a sand mine or a solar farm, that 100-foot buffer, if there's other large tracts around it, doesn't necessarily always capture everything around it. So we feel like it's appropriate to increase that distance. So we've got a couple quick sections in here. First is under the executive summary and commentary in the ordinance. And again, that's just changing it from 100 to 500 feet is what we're proposing. Section 3, the public hearing requirements and procedures. Section 3M3, this is for specifically conditional and special use permits. And again, just say that any portion of which is within 500 feet is what we're proposing instead of the 100 feet. Same for section 13H2, which is the notice of hearings for appeals, variances, and interpretations. Again, changing that to 500 feet as well. Section 14E3, public hearing requirements for zoning amendments. Again, also changing to 500 feet. And just to give you an idea, kind of how many more properties this sort of request could take in. This is a request that came before the board several months ago. You might remember it's Eastern Pines Road, it was a rezoning request. Under the original request, under the 100-foot buffer, that's the number of properties it would have taken in. That's 17 mail notices. I think we actually extended that and included a few other people as well, particularly people that had called in and had seen the public hearing sign that we posted on the property. So we had actually mailed out more notices than that. But if we went strictly by the 100-foot buffer, that's the number it would have taken in. Now, if we had the 500-foot buffer, this is the number of properties it would have taken in. So it would have included an additional 47 properties. So we feel like in a county of this size, we feel like a 500-foot buffer is more than sufficient to solicit the number of people for public comment that we think would be appropriate. Now, there is some cost associated with this from our end. In order to increase this number of mailings, it would cost us about, and this is sort of an extreme number here because of the amount of development that's around this site. But for something like this, it would increase our postage cost about $22. And that's per mailing. And we do two mailings. We do one for planning board and one for Board of County Commissioners. So we're talking an increase of about $40 to $45. But again, that's something that we feel like we can cover with our current rezoning fees. So again, we feel like a distance of 500 feet, it's consistent with and exceeds the requirements of several other counties. In your packet, there's a listing. We did a survey of other municipalities and counties as far as what their distance requirements are. Several counties were within the 300 to 600-foot range. There was a couple that went up to 1,000 feet. But after talking to them, they said that really, when they went up to that far, they didn't get any more people coming to their meetings than they would have at 500 feet. So we feel like 500 is very appropriate and would be more than sufficient to get additional property owners to provide notice to them for these hearings. So as far as our consistency statement, again, we feel that the proposed amendment will allow our staff to continue to promote an effective jurisdiction-wide land use program by ensuring that adjacent and nearby residents are adequately notified of proposed amendments or development that could impact their property. In terms of the reasonableness and in the public interest, we feel like it will increase public participation in the public hearing process, also providing additional notification of upcoming hearings to residents within the vicinity, and that, again, we feel like it's consistent with or exceeds the requirements of several other jurisdictions throughout the state. So our recommendation tonight would be to forward this language to the Board of County Commissioners with a favorable recommendation. That hearing will be on December 19th, at which time they'll take action on that request. And with that, Mr. Chairman, we'd like to open up for public comments.
Question?
Yes, sir.
The I see you here, you said rezonings and adjacents and SUPs and variances. Mm-hmm. Is that exclusively to those particular sections, or is it open up for, I noticed in others it said variances and CPUs. So are we keeping it just around variances?
No, sir. This is for all of our public hearing requests. This is for all rezonings, conditional use, special use permits, and variances, appeals, whatever hearing or whatever type of process in our ordinance requires a public hearing. They'll have that 500 foot separation.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, I'm glad to see you go to 500 feet because that gives more folks involved in the community where these things are taking place.
Sir.
And then they don't have no reason to complain that they didn't get a notice. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know a lot of them coming here for 100 feet, their surrounding people don't get it. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a wise choice that y'all have made, and the money ain't no problem. The $45 thing ain't going to be no problem with James Rose is looking at the money over there in the planning department.
Like I said, that in that case, with that number of notices, that's sort of an extreme example, just because of you have Brittany Ridge and several other developments around it. So there's a lot more lots that come into play. I think for the most part, most of our increases will be far less than what that would be. So.
I totally agree.
Yeah, I think the one you showed was the perfect example of why. You know, I remember that one, and I think several people came in and said
exactly.
They didn't. We
had probably six or seven people, I think, for that
all
meeting.
They saw was the sign and called about that day and didn't know, so.
Yeah.
And there are signs that are going up in addition to that.
And what we do is we're also required to post a sign on the property that notifying everybody so that if you don't live adjacent to it, if you just live in the area and you drive by it, then you'll still be able to call us and get some information on the request.
I think it's great because so many people say sometimes that they don't get the notice or they don't know what's happening. So I think it's a great idea to do this. And I would make a motion to that effect if you're ready.
I second the motion.
Been moved and seconded to forward this to the county commissioners, the staff request. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, by a like sign.
Thank you, sir.
Derek. Mr. James Rhodes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and congratulations on your election. We've got a few informational items I'd just like to bring you up to date. Most folks are asking these days, how's flood recovery going? And I tell you, we are kind of in the throes of it now. The response period's well past now, but we're in the midst of recovery. Just some ideas of what we've been up to since the flood. You can see on the screen here, we've had a number of our staff members out in the field actually doing preliminary damage assessments. And on this home here, he's actually pointing to the water level that the floodwaters reached on this home. So it was about 3 foot inside this home here. This is out in the Stokes Road area. But I tell you what we were able to find out and use during our preliminary damage assessments, we actually had an app that you could use on your cell phone. and staff members were able to go out in the field, and if you see the map here on the side, these little symbols that look like houses, because that's what they represent, show the places where we've been out to do these preliminary assessments, and we either put a yellow sticker on there if there was some minor damage, if the structure had some water underneath or maybe got into the duct work. But like the structure here on the screen, if it actually got within the house itself or at the finished floor elevation, the orange sticker went up. And both of these had numbers for our for contacting our inspections department for a courtesy inspection, so folks that lived there knew what they needed to do before re-entering that home. There might be special permits, there might be other precautions that need to be had. So that was kind of our way of going out and advising folks in the community. Also, when they went out, they put door hangers out. The solid waste division for the county will be soon mobilizing to pick up some of the debris that's been put out by the roadways. So folks were advised of that, as well as the inspections process when they went out. All said, we had about 215 homes countywide that were damaged, and this is excluding the city of Greenville, the town of Winterville, and town of Farmville that handled their own inspections processes. So within unincorporated Pitt County and seven municipalities, and the hardest hit, of course, was the town of Grifton as far as the municipal areas are concerned. 215 structures, some of those were actually commercial type structures, whether it's the Piggly Wiggly or Highway 55 restaurant down in Grifton. The majority of them, however, were residences, and we had, as far as the split there, the yellow stickers, the minor damage, had about 160, and the remainder, about 55, we felt like had some significant damage to those structures. And that was just a preliminary assessment. So that is just a key indicator as to what the damage was in the community. But they did follow up with the inspections department to ensure that the proper inspections were done. And those people, for the most part, are now back in their homes. But there is some active rehabilitation and restoration going on in certain areas. So in your package tonight on page 27, you actually had some indication about what's going on here in Pitt County as far as FEMA registrations. And we always like to pause here and say, folks that have not registered yet, they do have 60 days after the event to register. If they've had any damage, they might not even recognize the damage at the time of the event. But if they've noticed problems under their home since then, they really need to call the FEMA number and get registered. And, of course, we do have the Disaster Recovery Center open. If they want to meet face-to-face with someone, that's currently located at our agricultural center north of the river. So welcome any questions or comments you might have about flood recovery.
I just say thank you, James, to your staff. I was a recipient of Eli and another gentleman coming out and giving me the information, the packet that you were talking about. I thank the good Lord that it didn't go in my house, but it did make it to my garage and my outbuildings. And, you know, the information that I got and the fact that the county was going to pick up some of the tabs relating to debris removal, et cetera. Mm. Well, that was mighty nice. I mean, and I know people in my area, you know, we all had about the same, I think. I guess the ones that suffered the most damage had ductwork and whatever, not really, you know, doing a lot of damage to the house per se. But I was surprised two dumpster loads of what came out of my two buildings that I really didn't need, I guess, you know, in some one way or another. But anyway, hats off to your staff. And they were Johnny on the spot and very accommodating and had a lot of sympathy for the people involved.
Thank you for those comments. And just as a reminder, and this is more from the Solid Waste Division, If folks are putting debris out by the road, it does need to be separated, the construction debris in one pile, the vegetative debris in another pile. So just make sure the viewing public, if you do have some damage to your residence and you need some of that picked up, the construction debris goes in one pile and the vegetative debris in another. So we'll move on then. Next item, as far as informational items, we brought to you a couple of times updates about the Candlewick sewer project, and this is moving along. The commissioners dealt with this at their last meeting. We did get approvals for a couple of things. And you can see here on the map on the screen now, kind of the project area we're dealing with. And so what we were able to do is get approval to go ahead and start. There are some easements that need to be acquired to actually construct this line along Stantonsburg Road from where it currently terminates out to Candlewick subdivision and an area north of there. So this is about a 2 mile length. This is also the new Southwest bypass is being constructed. So we're having to kind of finagle our way through that construction area too. But we're acquiring easements and in a lesser extent, a little bit of property on a couple of these locations for a new pumping station that will be put in out here. Now we've got two options that we'll be bidding out. That's the other action that was taken. The commissioners have authorized us to go ahead and move forward with bidding this project. The funding is coming through a state grant. Actually, it's a federal funds through the state. And we've got our base project that will just service a smaller area here, bounded in the dark black line, or an upsized portion where Greenville Utilities has agreed to provide additional funding to make the line size larger, pump station deeper to accommodate future growth. So we're going to bid out both options and determine what's going to be the best option for us to move forward with. So we'll keep you posted on that. But that project needs to be completed in the year of 2017 because we've got to close it out in 2018. So we'll be working hard and heavy on that in the upcoming months. Also, subdivision street improvements. We're making good progress. You may recall, and this for Mr. Guth anyway, we do have a policy whereby if there are public rights of way in subdivisions and the developer is no longer available to keep up those improvements and didn't have them turned over to the Department of Transportation for maintenance, the county will actually provide the funding to upgrade the roads with those affected property owners paying that assessment back over about a 10-year period. So the one that we have under consideration now is Woodmore Drive and a portion of Trails End in Woodmore Subdivision. And we've already approved at last month's commissioner's meeting the preliminary assessment resolution. We've got a public hearing about that coming up at the next commissioner's meeting and also considering the final assessment resolution then. All said, if that action's taken as predicted, we'll move forward with bidding this out during the winter months so we can start construction on this, hopefully in the early spring once the weather breaks. So just know we'll be doing a little bit more construction work as far as road maintenance out in the community as well.
Mr. Rhodes, who initiated that? Was that initiated by the neighborhood?
It is actually, and state statutes dictate that percentage of folks owning property along the roadway that have to agree to it, and that's the 75% threshold. And in this case, we had very close to 90% agreeing, which is outstanding. It's just really hard to get 90% of anybody to agree on certain things. So, and this, of course, came along with a price tag. So folks, when they signed up or signed the petition for this, they knew that it meant an assessment, a tax assessment coming their way for several years after it. But the roads are in pretty bad shape here, and they could, of course, impact property values in the future if those roads aren't maintained better. Good question. Any other questions on Woodmore? Okay, a few other things. Your subdivision ordinance amendments that were before you at your last meeting have been approved by the commissioners. Remember, that dealt with stub-out streets for some of these new developments and where those stub-outs were required. Those were approved. Just for those of you, we were just talking about Woodmore subdivision and public road rights-of-way. Also in your package tonight, we did have a newer subdivision where the streets have already been taken over by DOT. This is the ideal situation where right at the time they meet the threshold for all the density requirements that DOT requires, going ahead petitioning DOT to take these roads over for perpetual maintenance. That's an ideal situation, so we included that in your package tonight. Lease program for buyout properties, and one reason we included that, just know, had we not purchased properties after Hurricane Floyd, some more than 100 properties were acquired in the county's jurisdiction, more than likely these same people would have been flooded again this time. So this is just a good example of the hazard mitigation program working its best here, where we've had another flood event and these people were out of harm's way this time. Final thing is, we've got a couple of monthly reports for September and October included in your package, and Tab has also included several items of interest from the local newspaper for your review as well. So with that, Mr. Chairman, that's all we have for tonight's meeting.
Okay, as always, thank you, James.
All right.
Mm-hmm. See any further business coming forward to the board tonight?
Party.
Christmas party.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Y'all want to RSVP
publicly? Publicly RSVP.
Publicly, yeah.
Ms. Tabitha, you got his public RSVP Christmas party. Yeah, everybody got that in your packet. If you hadn't been, you're missing a good meal and good fellowship.
Yeah. Motion to adjourn.
I got a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
All right. So, cloud emoji. Meeting adjourned.
Oh, okay. Good meeting, Mr.